you know, going from day one to day seven, that if you get into mixed precip types, or if you have, you know, your non-precip, then you just add grids for the different types that you need. And then if you, for some other reason that they are not going to occur, you just delete them or adjust them for wherever it's not occurring. There's also, again, the new procedure to create precip types, which allows the top-down methodology, and I'll show you how that works through examples. And there's a few other tools, and there's actually a whole slew now of tools that have developed over the last 5 or more years here with the methodology. Any questions up to this point about the methodology, anybody that you want to ask before I go into the examples?
Does the whole office use this type of methodology, or does it vary among forecasters?
Nope, the whole office does. In fact, that's where it's most powerful, because then, you know, if every forecaster is working within the probability of type framework, that they you know, they can just adjust them as needed.
Okay.
Yeah. Again, the nice thing is you have all the information that's in the weather grid retained in these probability types, and so if, you know, if you just need to do something with you need to do something with fog, or if the rain snow line is shifted into a different location, it's really simple to update. Any other questions? All right, well, I'll jump here with the example. I'm basically going to use one case here. This is December 1st, 2007, and this is a case where I built a lot of the top-down stuff on. The nice thing about this case was it was a freaking mess here for the La Crosse area with a ton of different stuff going on. I'll show you that in the first few slides. In this case, there was a multitude of precipitation types, anything from heavy snow to heavy sleet to decent amount of freaking rain to, you know, rain eventually moving in. So the whole shebang, lots of ice, you name it. And this thing's nasty. Here's if you're curious, the actual synoptic, again, I just have one screenshot of this, but you can see the system coming out of the southwest flow, big slug of warm air coming in aloft. You can see that you probably have some dry slop probably working in coming out of the southwest as well, the short wave to help scour out moisture. Then you'd have the shallow cold air in place to allow for a lot of E-type problems. A few images here for soundings. I highlighted the zero C isotherm. Here's the sound in 18Z, you know, for La Crosse, all snow. No problem there. But then at 0Z, here comes the warm air aloft at 750. Well, that's probably a snow fountain until you get down to the, or now, probably be mostly a rain fountain until you get down below 800, and then you refreeze back into sleet. And then you go to 6Z, and I don't have 12Z shown here, but it's about the same. That, well, then you start to lose ice aloft. As that triclop punches in. So, again, there's a lot of stuff going on. It's a mess. So I'll show you how it's all evolved through the process here. Do some just quick look at what I've thrown in for some GFE data. Basically just using the GFS or a blend of the GFS SRS, and NAM wasn't available for this on the web. So here's just temperature at 0Z. Nothing. I just really want to have these shown here in the background in order to keep in your head. Bops, no, you know, they're precepts. Nothing surprising there. Here's QPF. A lot of QPF for this event. Snow ratio. This was just directly populated from the GFS. And then I did a little smooth on it. So I'm going to run through a couple different ways, different approaches to show you how this methodology can be used both in terms of the simple rain snow scenario, and then we'll add in things like warm air loss, we'll add in a loss of ice, and then finally we'll add in that shallow cold layer with that potential for refreeze into sleet. So first we'll start off with rain snow, and you know, general operations here, how we use the methodology is going to be shown here is step by step. So the first thing we do is we jump in to the winter weather group, and again we're going rain snow scenario. We've done all those again. That first step of doing the temperatures, the wind, the pop, the QPF, the snow ratio, that's all been done. We'll say it's been done, collaborated. So now we're on to that part of editing the probability type grid. So again, that's step one, going to winter weather group, and then I'm going to run this procedure called create precip types. And in that procedure, you just note that highlight a time range before you run it. And there's a lot of options on this GUI, but the default is set to a rain snow scenario since that's the most common. So I just say my normal layers at the surface, leave that alone, modify the surface temperatures. Usually those could be a good proxy as far as what your type is, whether you're going to be snow or rain, and you could use you could look at your wet bulb zero heights and AWEPs and see if there's a temperature that kind of correlates pretty well with that. So just kind of some sample output. What this procedure does, you'll see there's grid there for pop rain, the probability rain, and then pop snow, the probability snow. And you have 100 in that area where the temperatures were greater than 34. And then for the snow, 100 where the temperatures are less than 37. And again, it's completely hourly. It's using your hourly temperatures to dictate where the rain and snow should be and where the overlap will be too. Okay, so that's all done. So that's, again, this is simple rain snow scenario. So I've done that. Now I'm going to do the step three in the methodology process, which is creating the snow amount ice accumulation. And there's this quick procedure. Actually, Dan Baumgart here did a lot of the coding for this and had some slight adjustments made from the Marquette office. Really made this tool pretty robust to incorporate all your probability type information and your temperatures to help determine what the snow amount will be. Again, I always say, remember to highlight the time range. There is, in this box, there's an option for sleet to give you either one to one or a 2 to 1 or a 3 to 1 ratio. From this December 1st storm, we found that 2 to 1 is a pretty good approximation for sleet. Of course, this scenario I'm giving you rain snow, the sleet won't be any impact, but just thought I'd mention that. So here's an example of what the snow amount produced. And then you get that same smooth line that was in the snow ratio. And I'm not going to show ice accumulation because we just show the rain snow scenario. So last step here will be to merge the grids together. And you just highlight again the time range that you're looking for. And in this case, I think probably 80 to 90% of the time we're just running the default that the GUI puts up. You may want to go in there and change coverages or a few other minor tweaks, but most of the time you just start up the GUI and merge it and hit the run dismiss. And here's actually a sample output. And so you'll see a lot more kind of detail put into these weather grids just from the fact that it's trying to make sure that you're okay with respect to your hourly temperature data. So yeah, I'm just going to show a snapshot. At the end of the presentation here, you'll see a full loop. So here's sort of a review of the rain snow. Pretty simple. Do the first normal step, and then jump in the group, run the create precip types and adjust temperatures if needed, run the snow mile isocume, and then merge, and boom. And, you know, one of the problems I had coming back in November is that we had a rain snow scenario here, but then we lost ice. And so one of the things you can do is in this rain snow scenario, produce these, you go in and edit these probability ice present grids, which I'll discuss here a little later, and then choose that appropriate option in the GUI to use the create precip type. And so you can handle the rain snow with lots of ice. And it can work pretty well in the extended too, when you probably won't want to put freezing rain and sleet in there, unless you're really, really, really confident. All right, any questions on rain snow? All right, let's go to something that produces a lot more P-types. That's when you get the warm layer to function a lot. So, similarly, we've done that first part of the methodology, edit in the temperatures, QPF, POP, snow amount, or not snow amount, snow ratio. And then we jump into the top-down group. This is slightly different now. We're going to jump to the top-down group. And for step two, we'll modify these max temperature loss grids. And you have them again. So you have them for the GFS, you have them for the NAM, the RUC 13. And a sample here on the right is shown from what you'll see coming out of the GFS. And, you have Rayov and Tamdar data available too if you want to kind of look at that for their values. And the way that the max GLOP is created, it just scans up from the surface up to 400 millibars looking for the warmest temperature in the model. And I'm kind of using some of the stuff that from the rover. Correlation between the max teal loss and the warm cloud depth, which kind of helps you out a little bit in terms of using max teal loss as a proxy of your of the actual pipe, depending upon what the value would be. And sort of using the spectrum information that we know that the sweet and sweet kind of favoring that 2 to 3 D window for max teal loss, and you get more than that, turns more into liquid. Colder than 2, it's more snow. So that's how, when we get to the individual pipe creation, how that will be done. So we'll put, and I'll show a graph of that coming up here. So continuing on, you'll switch, after you've done those max seal off grids, go to the winter weather group and run the create precip type. And this time we're going to change, instead of that surface in the upper left of the warm layer, we'll change it to a loft, and again, highlight the time range before running this. And we're not changing anything else. That's the only change. So here's when we run it, here's how if you're going to use just max Q loft to determine the individual pipes, these are sort of the equations. Over the course of the summer, I plan on doing a little research study on looking at exactly how the max teal loss correlates. I mean, this is sort of vaguely what we kind of know with respect to the P type. And just if you were to use the max teal loss, like they don't have a problem with ice, don't have a problem with shell colors, allow sweet to form. This seems to be a pretty good proxy for the types, and I've actually run it through a couple other wet scenarios, and they play out pretty well with the actual observations. So here's a sample of the liquid output. Now, the reason I say liquid here is because the create precip type is going to produce first stuff for pot rain, and then it runs a procedure called pot-delayed freezing type, which separates out the rain rain and freezing rain. So all the liquid information gets put in pot rain. And then when you'll have pot freezing rain, which is the thickness of that pot rain grid that got temperatures below or less, less than or equal to 32. And then you have the pot rain work, which is actually the true rain output where your temperatures are greater than 32. So it's also nice for the forecasters because basically you only deal with the liquid. As a forecaster, you only deal with the liquid. You let the hourly temperatures dictate where it's freezing or not. So kind of gets rid of one p-type to think about. So it's really cool. It's a sleep grid coming out of this. So you can kind of envision this every hour that you see this sleep band going from, south to north, and that's in the during the afternoon is with this warm advection kind of taking place. And in this case, again, the sleet is only representing that part that's the resultant of melting by the neck, by the warm layer loss. And here's your snow. So done all that. Now we're going to generate the snow amounts and ice accumulation via that snow ice accumulation procedure like before. And show you the output here. It's just a sample for the snow. And that area over northeast Iowa, that's in this case mostly sleet. And you can see you get a little lower snow amount produced from that. And then a striation because from there up to La Crosse, you've got some sleet and snow mixed in, and then it just turns into snow, basically north of La Crosse. And here's a sample of the ice accumulation. And this ice accumulation isn't what happens in reality, because for this area down in Iowa ends up having some refreezing and the sleet problem initially. But I show you what produces. So in this case, ice accumulation is going to be mostly your QPF because the type ends up being mostly freezing rain. And then lastly here is to merge the grid together. And I just leave the default stuff as the options, and here's an example of that weather grid that would be produced. Now you may look at that and you'd be like, how many sleeping types are in there? And there's a lot. And it's accounted for different intensities for each type, different coverages for each. You got different mixes. But again, that's all to kind of highlight, just to kind of follow that max T a lot. So again, you're kind of using your max T, doing an environment forecasting for the P type. So for the max T a lot, it's really simple. If you just have a warm layer of loss punching in, you do your normal grid, you do this max T a lot, you run the procedure, and you've got all your types. So, and you can and say, well, the sleet is moving farther north in reality. Well, then I just adjust the max T loft grid to have warmer temperatures moving to the north. Run the procedure. Update the types. Run snowmelt, ice cume, merge weather. Again, the nice thing is snowmelt, ice accumulation, and weather are all derived. One thing of note is that if models are not accounting for evaporative dynamic cooling, that you may want to adjust the max T loss for that. It's max T loss, not max wet bulb loss. Be actually a little more complicated to do a smart init or to calculate in the background for wet bulb. Like I say, if you don't have to deal with anything with ice in the club, problems with losing ice, or you have that shallow cold zone, this is sweet. Any questions on just the max T loss? All right, well, we'll go to the next scenario. We're going to throw in addition to the max peel off, you know, throwing a warm layer in, we're going to now get rid of some of the ice in the clouds. I know this is from some of the ESPS surveys. We have this scenario happen down in like the Ducas area not too long ago. And actually up here, we had a lot of loss of ice in the clouds during the months of November and December, which caused some adjustments to the top down to make it work correctly. For loss of ice, again, just to repeat, you know, you're doing your temperatures, QPS, top, you know, wind, snow ratio beforehand. So I'll jump in that top down group again. Do the max peel off like we did before. And now we're going to do the probability of ice, which that's being sent right now. And the probability of ice, similar to max peel off, is available again for the GFS, the NAM-12, RUF 13. And you can look at this ice present grade sort of, you know, from an observational perspective, looking at your IR imagery and some of those color curves in DTD, kind of separate out, you know, your ice and no ice. I've got a list here how the smart in it, you know, if you're pulling this directly from the GFS, here's how it's, you know, computed. You know, you look for potential per steer feeder, then it goes through and actually, I need to change that to RH with respect to ice for a temperature date, my date here, cold. I use a lot of aircraft data has been collected for each temperature for a probability. So I'll jump into a bunch of weather group after I've done that max peel off and probably ice present. Next run, they'll create precip type. Again, so you see this common process that is taking place here. So we've done a max peel off, and we've done, we've got ice being lost over portions of the area. So we'll change the warm layer to be a loft, and the ice present to be a partial, part of the area. And then I'll run the procedure. So here's the hot rain, liquid sample. And it just give you a little comparison to what, when I took the ice out, but how things changed. Here for 60 December 2nd. They see before you had all these zeros kind of over the northern part of the grid wall. They noticed we got a lot of ice in that area. So now there's additional probabilities that have been factored in to say, hey, we may not have complete ice in place. So we've now up the probabilities for liquid. So that's going to be reflected. That's right. Yeah, the probability is freezing rain. This sample is at 0C December 2nd, not 6C for the freezing rain. And here's the true rain down there. Get that out. Kind of waiting here, watching the stuff being sent around to everybody for the grid, for the slides. There we go. And then here's the sweep. Again, there's really not a lot of changes to these that, other than what you saw there, more towards 16, because that's because the dry spot ends up being more after, in this 6 to maybe 12 feet window. But, and then if you look at the sweep, say it's 60 from both when you had it before max peel, when just max peel lock was used and now you had it in lock light, you see that a lot of the sweep has been kind of scoured out because, again, you're just dealing now with super cool water. Again, we haven't talked about anything with brief reason. And then snow. snow is going to be adjusted too because of the loss of ice. And this next slide that's coming up will show that you boost the snow up north because it's going into super cool the water instead. So again, if you saw, for example, your tri-plot's coming in faster than what you had, you're probably ice present grids, and you just adjust them, run the create precip types, and it adjusts all your types for you on the snow mine accumulation and merge weather. So we'll do that here. Here's the snow mine ice accumulation. Here's the snow amount sample. You still see the, again, this is 18 feet to 0 feet. There's really not too much dry spot effect here. You still have that sleet component. But actually, the values do get reduced a little bit down there. And I'll show you something that might be a little, maybe kind of slightly more, is when you look at that 0 to 60 period, you'll notice that the snow amounts, especially towards northern Wisconsin, have been, north central Wisconsin, have been reduced to account for that loss of ice. That tri-plot punching in. And here's the ice accumulation. Very little change to this, because especially for that one time period. And lastly, we're just going to update the weather grid. And next I will show a sample. Again, pretty much the same sample at zero Z the second, but that band of mixed precip types. I believe at this point, if you are curious, that zero Z La Crosse is reporting mostly sleet and some freezing rain beginning to mix in. Rochester, Minnesota there, will be reporting, I think it's reporting a mix of rain, freezing rain, or not, or just freezing rain, sleet, snow, at the zero Z. So, again, but I haven't talked about the refreezing and the sleet. So, again, if you have, a warm layer coming in aloft, and you have a lot of ice, you just update that into the process. You just you do the same GFD elements, jump to the top-down group, modify max DLOS proper ice presence, jump to that winter weather group, run the create precip type, do a few modifications to options, run the snowmelt ice accumulation procedure, and merge weather. As you can see, that there's a lot of like kind of step-by-step process with this, and it can take a while to get used to, and that's why we the Smart Tool Task Force decided not to have this as force it on you to use it, because there's a lot of stuff to get used to in here. But I think this methodology is best to start up when you get into maybe a one precip type, and then they come like later, later this thing. I mean, you certainly can try it out now and get used to this control and try it out on certain events. Certainly not. Then you can't do that. So some additional information here for that. You still have that problem with evaporative dynamic cooling for the max DLOS, and then for the probability ice present, if you have it just doing you can just edit those grids by themselves, and that's typically what you might do for a rain cell, just to use that warm layer surface. Any questions with regards to that probably ice present? All right. Well, the final sample and what happens in reality for this. Again, it was a messy, it's a messy one, so forecasters would have to modify the max DLOS. Again, they have data for this, and you have probably ice present and the probability of refreeze into sleet, thanks to the shallow cold dome in place. You might wonder how this would be, change, well, heck, I've got to edit three grids. How can that be time consuming? Or how can that be time saving? Well, if it comes to an update, then it could be pretty easy. Then if you have to adjust something, that I've got my ice being lost faster, or the shell column lingering around longer, I just modify the grid. Use a couple of grids, run the create preset type, update my key type, and then merge the weather. So for this scenario with the recreate the fleet, just go in that top down group, and then we'll do the max T OAuth grid as before, and do the probability of site present grid again, same. Same thing shown here as we set up. And lastly, the refreeze the fleet. Okay. And one thing to know about refreeze the fleet, and it's a good time to talk about the way that linear interpolation works in GFB. I guess right before I talk about that, the refreeze the fleet. Look for a cold dome that's at least 2,500 feet thick and colder than -2C to kind of agree with the what's been found or when through some aerobic studies or when fleet is formed. And it kind of peaks out about -8, -9 to get about a 100% probability of refreeze fleet. So getting back to the interpolate algorithm, again, this is something you want to watch when you're doing the probability refreeze the fleet grid. And you may have seen this for the die and possum, you've been interpolating them. But the way you can adjust it, you can go into GFB, edit and preferences, interpolate algorithm, and then there you can change the whether you want to use like cubic advection or cubic non-advection. Usually one of those two are the ones that will make your interpolation work correctly. So we'll go into the winter weather group. Now after editing in those grids, go to the create preset types procedure. And then that's loaded. I like the time range and with the procedure, the create preset types. Okay, we've got the problem with max T loss, so we'll change that to a lock. We have the problem with ice present, we change it to partial. And we have a precipitation refreezing in the fleet, so we check that to yes. And here's the output. You'll actually see some pretty significant changes when this is run. Here's a sample for the liquid, and to give you a little bit better image here.